common topic, and I would say it is one of the most common presentation of pediatric endocrinology in boys, that is with a combination of delayed puberty and low levels of gonadotropin. So we're basically going to focus on hypogonadotropic hypogonadism in boys. In most cases, we think that this is physiological, which is true. How many of these cases who come to you with hypogonadotropic hypogonadism are physiological in boys? Do you think?
Percentage.
Yeah. 80%. Above 80%. So if you talk about entire delayed puberty in boys, maybe 70% are actually having a self-limited delayed puberty, or what we say constitutional delay of puberty in growth. 10% will have a functional defect. 10% will have a permanent hypogonadotropic hypogonadism, and maybe 7 to 10% will have something like Klinefelter syndrome or a hypergonadotropic hypogonadism. So if you talk about what we're going to talk today, maybe 80% are actually physiological, but a lot of them also have an underlying pathology, and understanding that becomes very important. There have been huge advances which have happened in terms of understanding of how the DNRH neuron migrates, how it works, and how do we evaluate and treat these conditions. So I'll start off with a case which will highlight how it is important to do a proper evaluation of these cases. 13-year-old boy who presented to us with complaints of delayed puberty had been evaluated outside and found to have a testicular volume of 3 ml, no pubic hair development. Parents were very concerned. So the doctor did some investigation and found a low LH and FSH level, and then did an MRI which showed a microadenoma. So Sayan, what do you think about this boy? Do you think this boy has a hypogonadotropic hypogonadism?
So first is, evaluation for delayed puberty shouldn't have been started in this case because the child hasn't become 14 years. Second is, testis volume has increased. It is 3 ml. No pubic hair is normal because I don't expect the child at 13 years to, all the boys at 13 years to have a high LH and FSH. So the MRI is creating problems in this case.
So this is a very, very classical picture because often boys are very concerned about delayed puberty and the parents go to the doctor and then they do the evaluation. Now this is hypogonadotropic hypogonadism, but everybody before puberty is hypogonadotropic hypogonadism. So we can say everybody who is pre-puberty is actually an impaired DNRH effect. No, this is a normal response for that particular age group. So why do we even need to do these investigations in this child is a big question, and that is causing all the confusion. Now, 7% individuals will have an incidental lesion on MRI on periphery, and again, that is not required. So this is an overkill which happened in this case and caused confusion. So best would have been, as Sayan said, wait and watch. He is already having a TV of 3 ml. What TV do you think suggests that you are not permanent HH? So when you talk about congenital hypogonadotropic hypogonadism, what is the usual testicular volume that you think of?
It is around 1 ml.
So 1.1 ml is actually found to have been, there are a lot of studies which are there, but 1.1 ml is considered to be the cutoff below which you should think of CHH, while beyond that, it is more likely to be CDGP. So 3 ml is big from that perspective in that regard, because if it is congenital, you should have no testicular development at all. Now, second case, which is there, a 15-year-old boy with delayed puberty, testicular volume was 1 ml. There was no anosmia, of course. LHFSH was again same low. Normal screening test and MRI. So what do you think in this case? 15-year-old boy, TV of 1 ml, no anosmia. What do you think, Sayan, in this case?
Sir, this is a case of gonadotropin deficiency.
Yeah.
The evaluation was done properly. No testicular growth almost. So this is most likely pathological.
So this is pathological, and you think this is permanent or transient or self-limiting?
So 1 ml, most likely it will be permanent.
So as I said, 1.1 ml, so it's like 1 ml is usually permanent. Now what happened was that he was given testosterone 100 milligrams every month, and 6 months later, he came to with a testicular volume of 6 ml. What do you think now?
So, as you previously mentioned, sir, it is always a spectrum of disease. So as the puberty has been initiated by testosterone, the central axis most likely has started working. So it is a reversible case at this point.
Yeah. So in this case, if you see, the most important that we are seeing is that there is a reversibility, and that reversibility is happening from a testicular volume of 1 ml. So this is an important finding which has now been found. And every time I take this talk, people will ask me, how do you differentiate constitutional delay from a permanent hypogonadotropic hypogonadism? Now, what you need to understand is that there is an emerging understanding that CDGP or self-limited delayed puberty, the term we are using more now, today we're going to use that term because many may have normal growth also. So it's not essential that your growth will be very short. It is usually less, but sometimes it may be normal. So self-limited delayed puberty and a permanent hypogonadotropic hypogonadism may actually be part of the same spectrum. Depending upon how much you are affected, you may develop as a delayed puberty. If you are having too much effect, you may actually present like permanent. Some may improve over time. So that is why this differentiation is quite blurred. Of course, when you talk about severe congenital hypogonadotropic hypogonadism versus CDGP, the differences will be stark. But when you talk about milder variants, it will be difficult. Many of the genetic abnormalities which are known to cause traditionally the permanent hypogonadotropic hypogonadism have now been shown to have been associated with a temporary finding as well. So again, this issue becomes important from that perspective. Now, what you need to understand is that there may be a tendency of reversibility, which is there as well. And that is why we need to understand that GnRH deficiency is a common problem. Most of them will be physiological, 80%. 10% may be permanent and 10% may have some systemic illness. So you need to be very cautious and aware about that in that regards. Now, of course, this is something which requires a lot of evaluation and management. This is what we're going to discuss subsequently. You can go and have a look at our website, learning.growthsociety.in, where there are a lot of resources available, including our masterclass course in pediatric endocrinology, pediatric endocrinology for postgraduates, our book, and our mobile application, which provides algorithmic approach for evaluation and management. Evaluation, because that's what the where crux is. So the four questions that you have to answer as a physician when dealing with somebody who presents to you with query, delayed puberty in boys is it really impaired GnRH effect or not? If it is there, is it physiological or pathological? If it is pathological, is it functional or actual problem? And finally, what's the cause? So to look for that, if you have these features, if you have micropenis undescended testis in the newborn period, delayed puberty, infertility, always start thinking about these situations. And if your LH and FSH levels are not high in these situations, think of HH. Remember, they may be normal. Normal LH level with a very low testosterone may still mean hypogonadotropic hypogonadism. Usually, if you have a congenital HH, the LH will be very low, less than 0.1, you won't be confused. But if you have a CNS tumor, radiotherapy, trauma, all those situations, your LH may not be zero. It may be low. So even if you have an LH of one and your testo is zero, it is very low. Like we say, if your TSH is less than 20 and your FT4 is low, it is central. If your ACTH is less than 300 and your cortisol is low, it is central. So a normal gonadotropin for a low testo is GnRH deficiency or hypogonadotropic hypogonadism in that setting. Next question, this is the most important question, is it physiological or is it pathological? Whether you need to actually do something in that regard or not. So when you talk about self-limited delayed puberty or what is known as CDGP, the key parameters are that there will be 70-80% will have a family history. You can also have family history in the other forms because that is genetic, but yet family history is very common. Your GnRH agonist response, your HCG response, your inhibin B level, and testosterone level will tell you which way you're dealing. The problem is that there is no 100% test. If you want to say 100%, follow up till 18 years of age and see whether they are growing or not. Having said that, I have seen children who have improved after 18 years as well. So there is no hard and fast rule. But people have tried to put up criteria as to what is good and what is bad to compare. So this is congenital HH. So this is congenital, not acquired. So acquired will of course be much less severe. So if you compare congenital with CDGP, what you see, testo in these are much higher as compared to these individuals. Do you see the difference? So this seems to be quite good. This is FSH. Is it good? But there is overlap. Many people with this have a high level. Now you can miss that. So FSH is a very bad parameter. That is What about LH? LH overlap is there, but less as compared to FSH. So testo seems to be very good. FSH is bad. LH is maybe okay. Then they try to do inhibin B. So what do you see inhibin B? Again, overlap is there, but the difference is quite much there. And they also looked at insulin-like factor 3, which seemed to be good, but then insulin-like factor 3 goes down with age. So it's not good around puberty. So which test to do is a big debate, which is there. And we will just look into clinical and biochemical parameters. If you have somebody who has got a pubarchy, what is it more likely to be? Is it CDGP or is it HH? Because it means that the adrenals have woken up, gonads have not woken up. So this is not constitutional delay. It is a HH problem, which is there. If puberty started and then stopped, it cannot be self-limited, because self-limited, the problem is in that your car is not starting. You have to push it to start. Once it starts, it goes on. So if it's stalled, it is important. If the growth is very good, if somebody is, there may be some variation, some overlap will of course be there. But if you have a normal height, it is unlikely to be CBG. And very importantly, if there is a history of micropenis, you cannot take it up. That time also there was CDG. It can't be there. So if somebody has got no pubarchy, puberty has not started, so stall doesn't arise the question. Growth is short, no micropenis. Usually you're talking about CDG. And the red flag signs are cleft lip, cleft palate, renal abnormalities, micropenis, and undescended testes. If you have any of these, you have to start considering that there has to be something abnormal in that regard. Now, which is the most important clinical parameter indicating towards CDGP? Exactly. So as I said, a TV of 1.1 ml and more has got the best predictive value, sensitivity, specificity, and ROC curve for telling you that this is more likely to be CDGP. Less than 1.1, it may still be CDG. But if it is more than 1.1, it is unlikely to be HH. You need to understand, there's a difference. If the testicular volume is 3 ml, it is very unlikely, complete is gone. So complete congenital hypo-hypo is gone. It is usually CDG. But if it is less than 1 ml, it can still be CDGP that is going to grow over time. So this is how you should understand that. Now, most important is, of course, age. Now, this is what tells us is that if you are CDGP, 90% of them will not enter puberty by 14 years. But as your age progresses, the number comes down. So by 18, still 15, 20 do not enter puberty. So you have to wait maybe a bit more. At 20, the number will be much less. So people take 18 as an arbitrary cutoff. But I'm not going to wait till 18 years to see what is going to happen. Because if you have delayed puberty, it is going to influence your height, initially at least, and maybe final height as well. Psychosocial effect, teasing, bullying, everything, and very importantly, bone density. There is studies which suggest that people who have got delayed pubertal onset have got lower bone mass in adulthood. Now, is this an association or is this a causation? How will you inquire? How will you know about that? Mendelian randomization. So people have done a Mendelian randomization, which is a very interesting concept in which you look at genetic contributors to delayed puberty. And then you see what effect they have on bone density and what effects delayed puberty has bone density. Then you link all of them and then you come to know that which is the main parameter. So Mendelian randomization has shown that CDGP or delayed puberty per se has got a effect, is the cause. It's not the association, is the cause of low bone mass. So it is better not to wait till 20 years of age. So you have to give them testosterone to push it up. This is an important message, which is there from that perspective. Now, how do you get to these levels? So this is a very important slide which we have made about the testicular volume and the testosterone level. So when you look at testosterone level, look at what the pubertal status is and what the testicular volume is. So as testicular volume increases, your testosterone level goes up. If your testosterone level is more than 20, we usually say, okay, this looks like you have entered into puberty in that setting. Very importantly, immune assays may be unreliable in this regard, then that may cause confusion in this setting. And you have to look at the GCMS if there is a doubt. But if levels are more than 20, it is CDGP. Less than 20, it can still be CDGP, it can still be HS. So again, these are more of ruling out than ruling in. More than 20 excludes congenital hypogonadotropic hypogonadism. What about gonadotrophins? LH is more important. LH more than 0.2 rules out HH in most cases. Less than 0.1 can still be CDG. So again, you need to be aware about that. Then if you give GnRH, if levels go above 5, it excludes HH as a possibility. So we've talked about testo, baseline and stimulated, testicular volume, and all these parameters become important in that regards. So if your baseline LH is more than 0.2, if your GnRH stimulated level is more than 5, and GnRH stimulated agonist deficit is more than 5 again, it's most likely a self-limiting or a CDGP-like picture in that setting. Now, which of these is more important? And we need to understand that. This is a very interesting paper a few years ago in which they looked into various parameters and drew the ROC, IRB, ROC curves. And what they found was that if you use testicular volume and inhibin B as a combination, your probability of HH becomes very good. You know what they're saying? If your TV is less than 1 mL and your inhibin is less than 50, probability is 90%. So TV is also less, inhibin is also less, 90%. As your inhibin goes above 111, the probability of permanent becomes 0.2. So within the testicular, so testicular volume is important, but within the testicular volume, it is this inhibin level which gives you the prediction. However, if your testicular volume is above 1, the chance is only 20%. You get the point. If your TV is more than 1 ml, 20% only chance may be permanent. And if your inhibin is also more than 111, it is 0. So if you combine TV and you combine inhibin, you know where to go. If your TV is more than 3, I think forget about it. Don't do anything. If your TV is just borderline, do inhibin. These two will give you the diagnosis. And you remember this table is very, very good. So 10 to 50, 50 to 110, 110 and above. This is how you can classify. So this is one. Of course, this is one center. It is not going to be 100%. Everybody is not going to behave like that. But if you want to really go ahead with the diagnosis, look at TV and inhibin. It will give you the picture in that regards. So if we finally summarize, if growth is retarded, bone age is retarded, pubic hair is absent, TV is more than 1 ml, post-GnRH LH is more than 5, inhibin B is more than 35. Now, based upon this, you can say maybe 100 will become even more reliable. You are dealing with CDG. If the growth is normal, bone age is mildly delayed, if pubic hair is present, if testicular volume is less than 1 ml, GnRH stimulation is less than 1, inhibin B is less than 30, it is HH. But again, don't be dogmatic. Either way, you have to give them testosterone. So it doesn't make a huge difference. Initial phase, give them testosterone for 3 to 6 months, and then we go from there. So this is important from that perspective. We don't do HCG test much common. I think inhibin B, LH, testo, and TV. These four are the best tests to look at. GnRH stimulated, I don't see much because that child had a good response, bad response to GnRH, but later on progressed. So I think that is not important. You do LH, you do inhibin, you do TV and testo, of course. So, and you can do it sequentially, LH and testo first. If your LH is more than 0.2, testo more than 20, end of the story. Low LH, low testo, TV less, do inhibin. This is how I'll probably say to go forward. Now finally, functional or not, again, if the growth is retarded, bone age is retarded, pubic hair is absent, TV is there, and you have systemic features, think of functional. If there are no systemic features, think of a permanent HH, do a prolactin. So always do prolactin. Rare, but this is a treatable cause. And look at systemic workup and nutritional assessment to look for anorexia nervosa, celiac disease, and all those abnormalities become important. Final question, what is the cause? Always get an MRI in everybody. And what you're going to look at is, of course, the stalk, the hypothalamus, another area. One region you have to look at very closely is why pineal gland? Is the olfactory bulb. Because if it is any of those migrational defect, be it FGF8, FGF receptor 1, CAL1, NOS1, your olfactory bulb will be hypoplastic. So that may be the only finding you will find on MRI. Of course, the aim of MRI is not to find the olfactory bulb. The aim of MRI is to find a craniopharyngioma, a tumor, a lesion, which is there, but look at the olfactory bulb as well in that setting. Do a genetic workup if you have clinical features. Now NGS are easily available, but people are not very clear whether everybody should undergo a screening, because whether it's going to make a difference or not in terms of treatment is there. But if you are in doubt, if you have concerns about future generation being affected, you can do an NGS or a targeted panel based upon the clinical features. So if there is anosmia, think of Kalman. If there is skeletal dysplasia, think of FGF. And targeted panel may be done in this setting. And very importantly, even if you have isolated hypogonadotropic hypogonadism, do a pituitary workup. Look for growth hormone, look for thyroxine, look for cortisol, prolactin. Prolactin, of course, as I said, it could be a hyperprolactinemia which is causing these problems. And look for testosterone and estrogen, of course, as part of evaluation. And DI, less likely. Which causes of permanent hypo-hypo will cause DI as well. Which one? Prop one. So yes, so very, very proximal, which is causing a hypothalamic problem, H6-1. Number one. Number two, brain tumor, craniopharyngioma, those can cause DI. Hypophysitis, histiocytosis. So all infiltrative disorders, because they're going to infiltrate the stalk, and that's where the problem will happen on that regards. How to approach? So this is the basic approach for delayed puberty. Do a screening test. So CBC, ALT, all that you have excluded. Celiac, thyroid, everything is excluded. And then your gonadotropins are high. This is a different pathway. We'll have a second class on this part later on. If your gonadotropins is low, look at prolactin and pointers to HH. And these pointers to HH include micropenis, undescended testis. We discussed about the red flag signs, renal abnormality, synkinesia, dental abnormality. So any of this. So any of those features, if they are there, or headache, vomiting, seizures, those are there. Start thinking of a GnRH deficiency. Consider an MRI head or a genetic test. If your these things are not there, what is the test for? More than 20, nothing to worry, follow up. Less than 20, look at LH. LH, more than 0.3, mostly a 0.2, more than CDGP. Less than 0.2, 0.3, do a GnRH test. More than 5, less than 5. And I would say you look at testicular volume and inhibin B. TV more than 1 ml, inhibin more than 100, don't worry. This is fine, this child is going to improve over time. TV less than 1 ml, inhibin less than 35, this is a permanent HH most likely. So I think this is the crux. This slide is the most important slide to look at in the entire discussion.